everyone here. Hope you've had a good afternoon. Maybe got in that little nap. Got ready to come back this evening, and Jade said, it's 64 degrees outside. To think that, what, just 3 or 4 days ago, you couldn't go through the car wash because your doors would freeze shut if you did, because it was it got down to sub-zero. It was sub-zero. It was cold. And then 64, so I still took a jacket a little bit heavier than what I needed, but I don't know. The way things are going, it might be 40 degrees cooler by the time we get out of here tonight, so you just never know. What type of person do you think of when you think of an Old Testament prophet? Do you think of some wild-eyed, bushy-haired street preacher? Some of the Old Testament prophets seem to be of that breed. Think of Elijah, who challenged 450 pagan priests to a duel of the gods, and then personally led the massacre of those 450 pagan priests after the duel was over. Or Isaiah, who walked through the streets naked and barefoot for 3 years in Isaiah chapter 20. Some of the prophets were a little bit on the eccentric side. But the prophet Habakkuk doesn't seem to be of that group. From the very little that we know of him, he seems to be a more introspective, meditative type. We don't even know for certain that he did any public preaching at all. He may well have, but generally you assume that of a prophet. But the book of Habakkuk, as we have it, is essentially a private conversation between Habakkuk and God. It's not a proclamation to the people, or at least it's not couched that way. Except for a couple oft-quoted passages and a thematic link to the book of Job, we don't pay a whole lot of attention to the book of Habakkuk. My earliest memory of the book comes from Sunday school and has very little to do with the message of the book. As a group of 8-year-olds, we just thought Habakkuk had a cool name. It could be pronounced Habakkuk or Habakkuk. And since Habakkuk sounded like tobacco, we thought that was really cool, so we went with that one. That's the theme of Habakkuk does indeed bear some similarity to the book of Job. Both books question God about human suffering. For Job, it was very personal. He was suffering greatly himself and didn't understand why. In the end, God helped him to understand that he didn't need to understand and that he wasn't qualified to pass judgment on God's actions. Habakkuk was more concerned with the suffering of the nation of Israel. Fundamentally, he didn't understand why God would allow evil people to oppress righteous people, and in that, very similar to some of Job's questions. But then more specifically, Habakkuk didn't understand why God would allow evil pagans to oppress his own people, Israel. In the end, he comes to the same understanding as Job. Our job is to trust God, not to evaluate his wisdom or his actions. So far from being a wild-eyed eccentric, Habakkuk strikes me, at least, as being a very sensitive, humble, and kind man. He was truly concerned about conditions in Israel, actually in Judah. Northern kingdom was gone by now. There were some righteous people in Judah, but they were a minority, and justice was hard to find. Sounds a little bit like today, doesn't it? The good are in the minority and justice is hard to find. But especially when God said that he would punish Israel, both the righteous and the unrighteous, by sending the heathen Chaldeans, Habakkuk was shocked by that. The historical setting for Habakkuk is around 610 to 605 BC. That would be about 20 years before what we call the Babylonian captivity started. The destruction of Jerusalem in 586 would be the ultimate punishment of God's people, and that would be that roughly 20 years from the time Habakkuk wrote the book. We should also note that 605 was the year when the first group of Israelites were captured by the Babylonians and deported to Babylon. Daniel was one of those captives in 605. So people such as Daniel and Jeremiah and Ezekiel were contemporary with Habakkuk in Judah at that time. But in spite of the presence of such great men, Israel would be conquered by the Babylonians, aka the Chaldeans. Same people, different terms. It's entirely feasible that Habakkuk was an eyewitness to Daniel and his group being marched out of town in shackles. He could also very possibly have still been alive to witness the destruction of Jerusalem 20 years later. Even though God assured him that the day would come when the evil Babylonians would get their due, it's not likely that he would live to see that happen, because he would have had to live to be quite an old age for that. Last week we looked at the story of Jonah, and I asked, what's the point of the book? We can ask the same message of Habakkuk. What's the message? What's the purpose? In the case of Habakkuk, the main message is probably a bit easier to recognize than that of Jonah. The message of Habakkuk is that we should trust God in all circumstances, good or bad. Regardless of what we see happening, God is in control. He has a plan. His plan will work out. And Christian growth is essentially that. If I were to ask the question, how would you describe Christian growth? This would be a very good answer. Christian growth is learning to trust God more. Now, that has all kinds of implications and ramifications for practical things in daily life. But essentially, growing as a Christian is learning to trust God more. We can learn all the Bible facts. We can learn the ins and outs of Greek and Hebrew. We can quote thousands of verses from memory. But if we haven't learned to trust God fully in all circumstances, we haven't really understood Scripture yet. After learning that the unrighteous Israel would be punished by the even more unrighteous pagans, Habakkuk was perplexed. As of verse 2 of the book, he starts asking questions. Like the martyrs in the book of Revelation, he says, "How long, God, before you help us and relieve our suffering? O Lord, how long shall I cry? And you will not hear, even cry out to you violence, and you will not save." He gets more specific in a second round of questioning that starts down in verse 12, verse 13, which is a part of that section. He says, "Why do you look on those who deal treacherously?" Looking on is more than just looking down and seeing that they're there. It's more the meaning of interacting with, putting up with, maybe enabling them, allowing them to go on. Habakkuk was fully aware that the Israelites were not living faithfully before God. If nothing else, he had Jeremiah out there preaching in the streets of Jerusalem and highlighting the sins of Israel at that very time. But when measuring sin, when measuring the sins of a people, the Babylonians were a lot worse. Maybe God could inflict natural disasters, a plague of locusts or something, and let that take care of the punishment of Israel. But to use these uncircumcised heathens was more than Habakkuk could comprehend. So he wraps up the second question, sort of like some folks who call into a radio talk show. You know, they call in, they ask a question, and they say, "I'll hang up and listen." He has pointed out his problem, he has asked his question, and he is then content to sit back and observe. Chapter 2, verse 1, he says, I will stand watch and set myself on the rampart and watch to see what he will say to me and what I will answer when I am corrected. We see something of the kind of man he was when he says that he was ready to answer when I am corrected, or some translations, when I am reproved. He knew that God doesn't make mistakes. He knew that there was an explanation that he was missing, and he was ready to accept the answer, even if it proved him to be in the wrong. I like that idea. I like that about the man. He was a man of faith. He trusted God, but he also knew that he needed to trust God even more and was asking God to help him do that, even if he got a bit embarrassed by the answer. The actual answer that he receives doesn't come until beginning around verse 5, and it comes in the form of five woes that are given in chapter 2. Woes are warnings. We have other books that have woes. Think, what are the seven woes in the book of Revelation? Woe to Jesus in Matthew 23. Woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, all that. Well, there's five woe sections in chapter 2 of Habakkuk. In these five woes, the sinful practices of the Babylonians are described, or if you prefer, they are acknowledged by God. In other words, Habakkuk need not worry. God knows how sinful and how evil the Babylonians are. See, he hadn't overlooked that. It wasn't something that God was missing. The first four woes are about the general sins and the oppressive practices of the Babylonians. In verses 5 through 8, just to summarize each of the woes, verses 5 through 8, that's the first woe. They plunder weaker nations, such as the Israelites. Second woe, verses 9 through 11, they are greedy, never satisfied with the plunder they take. Third woe, verses 12 through 14, they build their empire on the blood of others. And the fourth one, in verses 15 through 17, they exploit the weaknesses of their neighbors. The fifth and last woe is given in verses 18 and 19. This is chapter 2. What profit is the image that its maker should carve it? The molded image of a teacher of lies, that the maker of its mold should trust in it to make mute idols. Woe to him who says to wood, awake, to silent stone, arise, it shall teach. Behold, it is overlaid with gold and silver, yet in it there is no breath at all. This was maybe Habakkuk's main objection. The Babylonians were idolaters. The Israelites may well have had their problems, but their God was a real living God. The gods of the Babylonians could neither breathe nor speak. So how could the living God let the people of inanimate gods prevail? God reassures Habakkuk that it is inevitable that the day will come when such people would be destroyed by the true and living God. Now, all of that is, might call it, the general information that God gives to reassure Habakkuk in his confusion. But we shouldn't overlook the introduction to the woes that we find earlier in verses 2 through 3 and 4, which I intentionally skipped over earlier. This is where the Lord starts to answer him and sort of introduced verses 2, 3, and 4, and then the woes start in verse 5. The Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak, and it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry, Behold the proud, his soul is not upright in him. But the just shall live by his faith. First, he was to write down this vision of five woes. And he was to write it clearly enough on these clay tablets that a person could read it even while he was running to spread the message. Think of the midnight ride of Paul Revere if he didn't have his message memorized and was having to read it off a tablet. Well, that's what Habakkuk was to do. Write it clearly on the tablet so that he can run through the streets proclaiming the message. It's not unusual for prophets to write down the message that they have given to the people, but the instruction to write it down seems to emphasize the importance and the certainty of what God is giving. It's not just words that you hear and then will vanish into the air. It's going to be written down on tablets clearly for all to read. It was also not unusual for the prophets not to fully understand their own message. And Habakkuk clearly didn't understand fully the message he was given. He knew that what he was writing was from God. He knew that he was writing it because God told him to write it. And whatever the prophecy meant, he didn't know when it would be fulfilled. Notice there at the end of verse 3, though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. As I already mentioned, Habakkuk probably did not live to see God rain down justice on the Babylonians. Many prophets didn't live to see their messages come true. And that is a key part of the message. The real message wasn't a promise that he would see the outcome, but that he would know that it would certainly come to pass. In other words, the most important part was for the prophet and his hearers to do what he says in verse 4. Live by faith. Not because you've seen it happen, but because God has promised that it will happen. The last phrase of verse 4 is one of the Old Testament prophecies that is most often quoted in the New Testament. If you have a Bible that gives cross references, center column reference or something, if you look there, you'll probably have three or four passages indicated in the New Testament where that verse, not too many Old Testament verses, are quoted three or four times in the New Testament. This is one of them. Tells us something of the importance of it if it's repeated that often. If we don't remember anything else that Habakkuk said, remember this: the just shall live by faith. Habakkuk didn't understand the mysterious ways of God, and that was okay. What mattered was that he trusts God in all things. Habakkuk 2, verse 20, at the end of the woes, is possibly the best known verse of this book, along with the phrase, the just shall live by faith. Even though this verse comes at the end of the five woe passages, that context is usually ignored whenever it's quoted. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Remember, it comes after the woes that had been given. The most frequent use, as far as I can tell, of this verse is a sign hung over the door as you enter into the auditorium of a church someplace, of a church building. It's intended to remind people to show proper respect for the room, or at least for the things that are done in that room, and whether quietness is the most appropriate attitude to maintain in a church auditorium is at best debatable. Is this a place used primarily for quiet meditation or primarily for Christian fellowship and worship activities? Whichever is correct, that's not at all the context that Habakkuk had in mind when he wrote that verse. Habakkuk had been wondering if things were out of control. The righteous were suffering with no relief in sight. Ungodly people were prospering. People who worship silent gods are going to defeat the people who worship the living God. What is a righteous person to do? And the answer is, the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. We know that there are some passages, particularly in the New Testament, that treat the Christian or the church as the temple of God. That's not the meaning here. In this case, the temple is most likely all the entire universe created by God. God is reminding Habakkuk of a universal truth. God is in control. Things will happen that we don't understand. Things will happen that aren't right. Good people will suffer. People will rebel against God, and it will appear that they are getting away with it. They will worship idols. But the fundamental truth of this world has not changed. The Lord is in his holy temple, where he ought to be. And all the earth is subject to him. And all who trust God can find rest and peace in that reality. What would be the most appropriate thing to do or say if we were ushered into the presence of God? If we came before the Almighty, with the opportunity to speak to him, what would we say? Or better yet, what should we say? We might have all kinds of questions that we've been saving up our entire lives just waiting for that occasion. Habakkuk wanted to maybe ask the questions that he is asking here. But what would be the reaction best suited to the occasion? One good option would be to put away our list of questions and break out in praise, as they do in the book of Revelation. Holy, 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 worthy are you to be praised. But God gave Habakkuk a different option. Be at peace. Be quiet. Soak it up. Whatever we might have to say on that occasion is probably drawn from our lack of understanding, or as with Habakkuk, with our anxieties. If anyone has anything to say in that situation that is worthwhile, it's probably God. Silence would be the best way for Habakkuk to acknowledge that God is in control. Silence would say, I don't understand a lot of things, but I know you do, and I trust you. Chapter 3 is Habakkuk's prayer, having received God's response, and after finding tranquility in the Lord's holy temple. The form of the prayer is that of a psalm. It even has that mysterious psalm word, Selah, S-E-L-A-H, three or four times scattered to it, just like we find through some of the psalms that'll be thrown in there, and nobody knows exactly what it means. The early part of his prayer has thoughts similar to the last few chapters of Job, Job 38 to the end. Job had asked for answers, and God's answers didn't go quite the way Job thought they might. God pointed to Job's human limitations with questions such as, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Well, Habakkuk's thoughts are very similar, only he has caught on, and this prayer is him saying that he understands better now. Having spent silent time in God's temple, he realizes that God's power is so great that there was never a good reason to be concerned. God's ways are everlasting. He can send plagues. He can send pestilence. He can shake mountains. He can make the sun stand still. And if God can do such things, then Habakkuk need not worry. God will take care of things. The righteous people won't be forgotten. The unrighteous will be punished. This litany of demonstrations of God's power that he gives concludes in chapter 3, verse 16. And there Habakkuk admits that confronted by the power and the wisdom of God, he trembled. He had asked for questions, but when the answers came, it was intimidating. No power, not even that of a righteous man, can withstand the power of God. Anyone who truly appreciates the power of God will be humbled. We won't run up and start just saying whatever comes to mind. But this healthy fear of God brings true and everlasting peace. So verse 16 says, "When I heard, my body trembled, my lips quivered at the voice. Rottenness entered my bones, and I trembled in myself, that I might rest in the day of trouble. When he comes up to the people, he will invade them with his troops." The NIV has for that latter part, "I will wait patiently for the day of calamity to come on the nation invading us." Even though God's wrath is directed only at the unrighteous, even the righteous will tremble. But that same realization brings peace. When the ungodly are troubled, God's faithful find rest. I'm a bit surprised that the last three verses of the book aren't better known than they are. This is a magnificent and eloquent statement of faith. This is one to put on your refrigerator. In Philippians 4:11, Paul said, "I have learned in whatever state I am there to be content." That's exactly the same thought that Habakkuk expresses, but I think Habakkuk's version is much more poetic. He's saying that no matter what goes wrong, by faith, I will rejoice in the Lord. Though the fig tree may not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, though the labor of the olive may fail, and the fields yield no food, though the flock may be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like deer's feet, and he will make me walk on my high hills. The fig tree, the vine, the olive tree, the grains of field, the flocks and the herds were the staples of life for people in Habakkuk's day. In 1 Kings 4, verse 25, we read of the time when Israel, one of the rare moments when Israel was faithful and at peace in God's care. And it says, "And Judah and Israel dwelt safely, each man under his vine and his fig tree, from Dan as far as Beersheba, all the days of Solomon." To dwell under one's own fig tree and vine was a colloquial expression meaning that life is good. Habakkuk says that even if we lose all the things normally thought to provide the good life, we will rejoice because we are in God's care. It's a challenging thought. If everything we depend on comes up short, what will we do? If the crops fail, the factories close, and the stock market crashes and takes our retirement funds with it, what will we do? Habakkuk says, if all that happens, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. He knew that by faith, his strength was in the Lord, and he would be okay. We are called to be patient and to walk by faith. Things on earth won't always go the way we want. Sin will have more success than we would like. Righteous people won't always come out on top. Often there will be no change in sight. But the just shall live by faith. We have faith that our greatest enemies, sin and death, have already been defeated by the death and resurrection of Christ. We are thankful that whatever material blessings we have, our eternal hope is not dependent even on those things. And so we sing sometimes, "Teach me, Lord, to wait down on my knees, till in your own good time you answer my pleas. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run, not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Teach me, Lord. Teach me, Lord, to wait." If you have not put your trust for your life now and forever in the hands of the Lord, this will be a good time to make that step and make that commitment, that you will trust in him and what he has promised and let him take care of the rest. If you need to respond to the invitation, please do so. Let's stand and sing.